Somebody just asked me this question. When we started the company, frankly, we were sitting at a red light, and we said, this is stupid. There's a better way to do it. So we came up with this idea. We kind of sketched it out, Vig and myself. And then I ran a bill of material of what it would cost to build a device to do this, and it would have been $250,000. So we said, well, that doesn't work, but if Moore's Law works and processing continues to double, the cost goes down, maybe someday. So we were looking for something else to do come 2006. Pulled out a lot of old ideas, this was one of them. Did the calculation and it was cost effective. But the other thing we did is we started Gridsmart. You know, Vig and I are not spring chickens anymore. We wanted to do things that matter. So the goal we really set out for was to bring some technology to the market that could wow them in Oak Ridge. You know, Oak Ridge National Lab is 10 miles from where we work. But we have some of the worst poverty in America when you go 20 miles in another direction. So we wanted something that was accessible and could work in Jellico, Tennessee, or anywhere else like that. So that was the goal of the company from the beginning. There's three principles that we try to do everything on: simple, flexible, and transparent. A lot of people in the market buy us. We're in 48 states and 22 countries, and most people reward us because we're simple. We're the easiest thing to do. A lot of people like the flexible. People don't overly care about the transparent. We do it because it's the right thing to do. And I believe it'll matter someday. So you'll hear a little bit about that when we talk about our products. But you're also going to get that as we come through here. I may insult some of you as we go through. Please throw it back at me. You know, one of the things that from my days, I believe a university should be someplace where you throw out theories and ideas and you have debate and you don't have a congressman breathing down your neck because you said something that he doesn't like and or his constituency doesn't like and try to pull funding on it. And that's exactly what we're going to do here. I'm far enough in the business. We make our own money, so I don't have to worry about anybody pulling funding from me. So we'll talk a little bit about the when and the why, a little bit deeper about the what, a little bit about the how, and then kind of the oh crap moment, if you will, for me. I'm editing from my Detroit background on that one. So right, why do we care about autonomous vehicles? Most crashes are because of humans. If you use this thing right, it's phenomenal, right? All the people who don't have access today, you know, I had to take my father-in-law's license from him because he hit that age, and it broke my heart. And it would have been incredible if I could have said, you're still going to be independent when that happens. More efficient use of the roads. You know, one of the reasons that we don't do well on the roads, particularly in the United States, right, it's the gaps. Somebody's going fast, somebody's going slow. If you ever go into London, they lower the speed limit as it gets more congested. It keeps you closer together. You get more access out of the lanes. That's something, right, with the robot driving, you can do that, and you can do that safely. I've just started hearing this one. I mentioned I'm around a lot of guys talking about autonomous vehicles. You can travel all night and sleep in your car. Sounds like a great thing. Most importantly, 35,000 people die last year in the United States. It's on its way up this year, 1.2 million worldwide. The other side, today to get the sensors, you add about $150,000. Insurance changes. If you think about it, you get insured for your car today. In the future, what's insured? Is it you? Is it the car? A lot of people think it's going to be the ride. Every ride will be a separate insurance policy. So life's got to change a lot for that. Cybersecurity, I can tell you this, traffic cabinets are completely exposed. All the old time, and I make people mad on my trade group when I say stuff like this, but all the old timers tell you traffic cabinets secure, that's crap. There's about five keys that open all the cabinets in America, and you can buy one off eBay, and you can access that controller. We did it. We had a city in this area, and that city of Knoxville gave us permission. It took us about 10 minutes to crack the controller. And if you have autonomous vehicles and every vehicle's connected, you can put a virus out like that. It's insane, which gets you down to terrorists. Also infrastructure cost and connecting with the non-connected. And then a couple of my pet peeve ones that are personal to me, not the rest of the industry. We have this thing called the Articles of Confederation, which actually is still legal unless it conflicts with the Constitution. Back from the 1700s, Article 4 says, you can't deny me my right to move state to state. If autonomous vehicles are controlled by somebody else, in my mind, you're denying me. If you do not let me drive my vehicle, you're denying me my right to go state to state. After World War II, we have the International Bill of Human Rights. It echoes Article 4, saying that free people should be able to move state to state. It also says you have a right to privacy. In a connected world, everybody knows everywhere you go. And I want you to think about that one, because I hear this stuff, you know, I don't have anything to hide, I don't care. Has anybody in here ever broken up from a relationship? Yeah? Anybody divorced? So do you want somebody, if you're gonna go see a divorce lawyer, do you want your enemies? Do you want somebody to know that you went there? What if you go look for a new job? Do you want your employer to have that information? Or a medical procedure, you know? Maybe I want to get a hair transplant, I don't think anybody will notice. I should have that right. So I have a little bit of trouble with these things. And I think technology can give us some answers. So I'm going to bounce around through the presentation, but think of three things: access, privacy, and control. Real quick, we're talking about deaths. This is the primary reason. Back when I was a young guy in college, we were losing 50,000 people on the road. It's technology that's brought that down. It's technology that's bringing it back up again because too many people are texting. But it's anti-lock brakes, it's airbags. Those are the kind of things that brought it down. We do an event at my company every year. It's a three-day event. We bring people in. Last year, we were real fortunate. We had the Secretary of Transportation in Michigan, Utah, and California come out to join us. This year, we're changing it up a little bit, and our theme is called It's Time We Had the Talk, and we're going to take on some of these tough issues around that time, and a lot of them are going to be about freedom around distracted driving, or driving in general, and distracted driving topics. One of our keynote speakers is going to be a guy who lost his college-age son in an automobile accident, and he's become the ultimate advocate for highway safety. And it's really a compelling speech he does, and his logic is...
It's a difference between those two
variants. Oh, I'm sorry. Yep. First one is deaths. The second one is deaths per 100 million, so it's just adjusting it for population. So it's even more impressive when you think about that we've went from 200 million to about 330 million, maybe 240 million to about 330 million. So autonomous vehicles, you might hear these things be thrown out about levels. A level zero, this is the way the government's categorizing it these days, that's nothing, that's your old horse and buggy. A level one, you gotta have your eyes and hands on the vehicle at all times, but there's certain things, there's certain advanced features, and I like brakes, actually, where the brake takes over for you. It's probably normal for most of you, but for some of us older, I grew up learning how to pump the brakes, and then all of a sudden the brake does it for itself. It took a little bit of adjusting. Level three, this is, you know, the famous accident we had recently with the guys out in California, the Tesla guys. It's where you can take your hands and eyes off, but you got to be ready at all times. And that's a challenge from a technology standpoint and a governance standpoint. When you hear them talk about four, you still have to be a licensed driver to be in there, and five, you can do absolutely anything. The world, it's nirvana. So when's it going to happen? Well, if you Google, it's going to happen in 2 years. I've heard the same Google guy telling me that his 12-year-old son is never going to have a driver's license because cars are evil and my son's not going to have to do that. And that kid, he must be Peter Pan because he's been 12 for like 5 years in a row here. But, you know, some people like Google are very bullish. You know, you got guys like Uber. I used to sit on the, Uber used to be on the board I'm on. You know, they're pushing it. They're pushing envelopes with technology. And you got legislative people who are pushing back. There's the National Highway Transportation Safety Board. We had a member of that on our board and an Uber guy. And it was worth the price of admission to see him go at it. And it was fascinating, too, because the Uber guy was right in one sense, right? We got to push technology. We got to go. And the highway safety guy was right. There are rules for a reason. People die, right? And it was a fascinating piece. But outside of Google, who will do no evil, by the way, Google won't be buying me now. This is a more realistic timeline that I've seen for folks, and one of the predictions is that in the 2018 to 2022 timeline, we finish the technology out, we get there, but it's another 20 years before you get 100% penetration. Now, the one thing that scares me about this chart is they do use that term utopian. Uh-huh. Mark told me I can't use dystopian, but the guys who did that actually just paid a $3.2 billion fine because they took advantage of a lot of people who didn't know better during the mortgage crisis. So again, it's the stuff that's on my mind as we think about who's going to control these things. Mark, my only dystopian slide, I promise, just had to have the feel to it. Something else you're going to hear about, the vehicles today, they're supposed to communicate through something called DSRC. It's a 5.9 bandwidth, and Congress set it back for the automobile industry in 99, and they didn't do crap with it. And they're paying for that now because in 2006, after all that time, I think it was GM got the first one out, and now the cable guys have woken up and they want it. And cable's trying to convince the world that it's okay that we're going to put every car, we can also run Wi-Fi off this and we can share it. Makes me a little uncomfortable. The organization I'm part of is pushing for that. There's also a belief that we could use 5G from the phone, which is not going to be out for another 3 years, but they're confident it'll work. And ironically, the same guys pushing the 5G are the guys who would benefit from the DSRC so they can run it on both sides of it. But somehow, you gotta have a safe protocol where these vehicles will talk to each other and they'll talk to infrastructure. So today, it's a 5.9 gigahertz bandwidth. It's about good for about 1,000 meters out. It's like the commercials you see, right? The guy in front of you slams his brakes on, your car knows, you know, somebody's up the road, the windshield wipers come on. Tremendous amounts of data, by the way, which we have no idea how to take or what to do with. I mean, you're talking, you know, a petabyte of data being generated from a vehicle. Where do you put it? What matters about it? So all big questions coming.
You're saying that Congress set aside this for the auto...
This safety, exclusively. Cable guys are coming after it. The lobbying dollars are huge. One of the funny arguments that the cable guys come is that you lose your privacy because the auto guys may spy on you and see what you're doing in your car. Wow, because the cable box doesn't do that.
Yeah.
They just got permission to do even more.
They do. So some of the hurdles, technology-wise, and we'll show you some videos here in a second here, but human unpredictability, trying to understand if you're in an autonomous vehicle, right? In my world, and I'll show you a little bit about my company, we take advantage of the fact that we know the cars are on the road and we know which way they're going. It's much, much more difficult. Like, I can't do pedestrians, for example. I can tell you when there's a pedestrian there, but I can't tell you what a pedestrian's gonna do, right? Matter of fact, quick little story. I used to drive through Alcoa, and that was one of our first systems. And I was going through on a Sunday, and it was backed up. And I was like, oh my God, we're messing up. We're doing something wrong. When I finally got to the light, what it was, there's a woman who was obviously very upset with somebody. She's on her cell phone, and she'd walk down the grass, and then she'd walk up the left turn lane. And because we are sensitive of tracking people, we picked her up, and we put a call in. So the system thought that there was vehicles needing a left turn. So humans are unpredictable. When you see the autonomous vehicles, excuse me, they tend to take advantage of perfect roads. You see the videos of them going straight. No potholes, well marked. That's not reality out there. So there's a lot we have to do with that. Ethics. You got a vehicle that's going to go, and it understands that if it swerves, you're going to have an accident where the occupants of the vehicle could be injured or killed. But the alternative is you run over three kids in the street. How do you program an algorithm to do that, and do you want to trust that to a machine? That's a question that we got to ask ourselves. We're talking about it, AI. How do you make that decision? I mean, there's an algorithm for it. The old Will Smith movie, iRobot, right? Who has the best chance of surviving? Insurance and rulemaking. It is phenomenal trying to understand who's going to make the rules. You know, can all autonomous vehicles take all the northbound lanes if there's no traffic coming south? Can they take five? Our congressmen, they're not even close to understanding how to do this. I mean, they depend on the 25-year-old staffers now. But, I mean, I think we're going to have a whole other generation of Congress to get into some of these things. technically, software's got to get better. It just can't cover everything that's possible now. We need better maps. Google's working on that. But you need to understand every place you can drive, better sensors. And then we talked a little bit earlier about the communication. So you'll see a few of these slides in there, right? Smoke around the campfire to steal an idiom. I get to sit around a lot of people talk about these issues, so I thought there might be some places in the presentation where I'd want to throw in some things I've heard. So I know John Augustine pretty well. He's from USDOT, and he's the director of infrastructure and the finance. He's trying to figure out how to pay for these things. And he makes a great point. Level 3, if you remember those vehicles, that's a lot harder than a level 5. If you just say the vehicle's going to drive itself and nobody has any rights and you can't touch anything, that's a lot easier to legislate than some people can drive, some can't. You got to put your hand on the wheel sometimes. So that's a consideration. That's a balance out there. They need road conditions. And there's a question. Is the government responsible to provide real-time road conditions to everybody all the time? And if so, how are you going to pay for it? Do it in aviation. Uh-huh. With gate fees, right?
Yeah.
Pardon me?
Railroads pay their own way.
Michigan, the state of Michigan, got a $1.2 million grant. They put gyroscopes on all the Ford F-150s that were driving around, sent the information back, and they could know how the snowpack was, right? By the way their trucks were bouncing. It was a great project. It was really successful, and they ended the call talking about it by saying, this worked wonderful, it can't scale and we can't replicate it. I mean, those are the kind of challenges. There's some ideas there, there's some innovation, but it's not, you gotta get paid for. John's other question he asked is, there gonna be 4 rush hours now, right? Instead of, you know, traffic coming in the morning, going back in the afternoon, is it the vehicles going in the morning, they're going back when they drop you off, where are they gonna go, what's gonna happen? People are, you know, I was talking to some parking structure guys, right? Parking structures are hard to renovate because of those ramps. They're actually making some more aggressive ramps now that are more difficult on your cars, but thinking ahead that they're gonna have to renovate those parking structures and make them into something new. This is a change. You're sitting at a change like nothing that we've seen in our lifetime. This is back, I think, you know, what our forefathers saw when they saw the Industrial Revolution. So NVIDIA is one of these companies that's got in the space. So these guys were gaming guys. They made chips for that, and now they're using artificial intelligence, and they're using their chips to process fast enough to do all this. So this is a friend of mine, Tim Wong, and I'm let him show you a little bit about what NVIDIA is doing.
See is that not only do we know that
So before I jump into Tim's overheards, what they're doing when they draw those boxes, that's called pointer edge detection. So the camera's looking out and it's grabbing every point and it builds a model around it. It's actually what we do at Gridsmart. And he had about five errors in there. Yes, sir.
So that didn't, you're talking about pedestrians and so forth. I didn't see any indication of that. So how does his system address
it? In his case, instead of doing it with visioning, they would try to use LIDAR or radar to find the pedestrian. And it would signal back that there's something there. But they still got to figure out how to distinguish it, right? So, yes? That's built. The idea is to go in the car and control the car. So he mentioned at the end an SDK. What they're trying to do is sell that to the automobile companies to go ahead and integrate it and write around their own software.
So you'd never see it.
Oh, you'd never see that, no. You know, it's funny, humans get distracted. We build models in our company like that, and I used to think it was cool. I'd show the models to customers, and people are so focused on, well, your model's not exactly right, they missed what it was doing. It's hard for us as humans. He had several errors. I mean, that was a major show in Europe. So, you know, you don't put something on that's not the best you could do. And NVIDIA is a very sophisticated company. He had several errors of detecting things in the way they went. And if you'll notice on the lanes, they were doing that in a perfectly straight manner. But they're moving. They're moving exponentially. And it really is the processing that NVIDIA has. It's amazing. They're doing multi-threaded processing. But a couple things Tim said. Using neural networks, they're 91% accurate in lip reading. So what they're saying is that we use lip reading when you give a command, right? You say, you know, call John Brown, and your phone says, you know, play James Brown. That's what they're trying to do. But they're also now have the ability with that camera, that's that, you know, how some of the Japanese cars, luxury cars, right, they have that, you fall asleep and it jerks you back. That same lip reading is good for anything. So, you know, like if you want to look over at your wife and say, you know, I love you, they know, or whatever else you said. And that's 91% today. Again, not trying to scare you, but just trying to think about the power that we're giving up so much. It's like this thing I keep hearing about where people say, I don't have anything to hide. Yeah, you do. You do. You have something. It doesn't mean it's nefarious. I have a conversation about access all the time. And I get in a lot of trouble in Washington with this, because they say, that's not a, you know, I say, how are you going to take care of people in rural areas? How are you going to take care of people in the bad part of town? They say, that's a policy issue. That's not a technology issue. Frickin' healthcare is a policy issue. How's that working out? I mean, seriously, I spend time down at Lonsdale. It's 3 miles from here, and the kids can't get vaccinated. I know there's enough vaccinations out there. That's not a technology issue either. They're using cameras with NVIDIA internal occupancy so that they know how many people are in your car at all times. Again, these are the things that naturally are going to come with it. I love to hear that they want redundancy in their sensors, and they are trying to mimic human behavior. So it is all about putting everything into the neural network with these guys. Now, challenges. Little known fact, I didn't know this till somebody told me. Three people in the United States die every day lying down drunk in the middle of the road. So I actually Googled it at one point, so we should be proud. I don't think that's happened at UT this year. Glad I got a UT student. Y'all know, right? That's somebody laying in the middle of the road. But think about trying to teach that to a machine. How does that look different than that? And that's my half-butt shot at Photoshopping, but that's a brown box in the road. But again, you know. You also know that you can run over a box if you have to, but how do you teach a computer that? How do they know when it's a box you can run over or that's a brick and you're gonna smash?
And how do you know it's a box you can run over?
Sometimes you gotta make a judgment call. You hope there's not a drunk in it.
Well, you hope there's not, you know, shards of metal in it.
And it does happen. That's a fairly recent. There was three people sleeping in the road. Huh. Two of them didn't make it. So what's this police officer telling you to do? Come forward, maybe? Go that way? So maybe I can mimic that and I can teach it to a car, but then does that mean the car makes a turn there too? I mean, how do you know the difference in the hand signal?
Yeah, right.
These are the things that we got to overcome to get to that level. And I'm not sure what this guy is trying to tell us. Maybe he had Taco Bell for lunch. But that's a tough interpretation for a car. You know, when you go Singapore, they're pretty uptight. I actually was given this pamphlet. I didn't know that this would mean stop. I would have thought he was telling somebody going the other way. But these are all ways we have to communicate that we have to get around. And I don't know this. I feel like I'd have to get out of my truck and spike something there. I mean, I thought I was doing good. So I got to hear this woman who, I won't lie, I fell in love with. Oh my gosh, she was so smart. She started two companies that failed. I was just saying this in an entrepreneurial forum last night. Companies fell. That's one of the things we have trouble with when you're not in California or Texas. They fell, and that doesn't mean your life's over, your career's over. You go do the next thing. But she had two companies that failed. She's an AI specialist. 2040. That's a prediction, and I think she's pretty credible when AI or artificial intelligence overtakes human intelligence. Although if you go back a couple slides, you might argue they already have. And 2060 is the top of superintelligence. Why I believe that they believe it is if you know Accenture, they want to be known as an AI company in 3 years. They don't want to be a consultant anymore. And so I bring this off a little off topic just because it is what's coming with artificial intelligence, and that is what will empower the self-driving car. I didn't get a chance to catch her after the session that she was talking about black data, and there's several different meanings for black data, but I want to illustrate why I think it's dangerous. I had some investors run a background check on me, and it popped up that I was the secretary treasurer of about 5 companies I never heard of. And I started trying to find out where this information came from. You know, went back to the investigative agency. It's not a bad thing, right? But I'm curious. I can't find, nobody knows. But then I started looking at one of the companies that said I was the secretary treasurer of the 7-Up Bottling Company of Chattanooga. And when I was reading some of their documents, they said about 10 times, this bill makes, fill in the blank, one letter from my name, Bill Malkes. So a computer somewhere saw Bill Makes repetitively, grabbed it. I've been the secretary treasurer of multiple companies in Tennessee, attached it, and put me there. I can't get that off the record. I don't overly care, but what if that was something else? What if I was identified as, you know, a neo-Nazi or Trump supporter? I guess. Told you I'd stir you up. Colleges used to be liberal, right? My daughter's here. I was amazed how many people were walking around with little Trump stickers. It's like I'm supposed to be protesting. Other technologies, as you think about what's got to happen, it took 25 years and a mandate to have airbags in. So mandate could be what gets driverless cars in. Standard transmission, automatic transmission, it's $1,500. We're only up to 90% in the U.S. after 50 years, only half worldwide. Some of us like driving that way, but navigation, we're about 80% penetration after 30 years. You know, jumping down to electric cars, I mean, gosh, 4%. And so autonomous vehicles today, it's $150,000. We know that price is going to come way down, but it does build another case of why you don't own your own autonomous car, why it ends up being owned by a rideshare or Google, Uber. That's actually GPS in the car. So a little different than the navigation tool, just having GPS so you know where the vehicle's at.
But you were talking about the lag, the implementation lag. Yeah, up there you got 100% of airbags, which isn't true because you've got...
That's true. That is.
They're pre-airbag introduction, so it's still not 100% after 25
years. Yep, that's a great point, right? What's it? There's lies, damn lies, and statistics.
There you go.
Mm-hmm. It's not. And the time it takes to get a car off the road, that beyond any pushback or resistance, that'll be a big piece of it. So who gets fired? Who loses their job? How does the world change, right, with autonomous vehicles? Obviously, taxi, transit drivers, anybody who drives a vehicle. Retailers. You have less foot traffic going in. You have these vehicles. There's already patents all over the place about self-driving vehicles bringing packages to you. Matter of fact, sitting with the city of Knoxville, they would love to have autonomous vehicles deliver beer kegs up and down the street, right? Because you got a narrow road there, you have a lot of bars, and there's not a lot of place for those bars to store, so they have to have frequent delivery, so you're always jamming up, even when there's not construction up there. Life and auto insurance changes, dealers, parking. All these people's lives get turned upside down. It's a lot bigger than technology. I don't know if anybody's ever seen this. I got it off NPR. It's an amazing story. That's the number one job title by state in 2014, I think it is. But if you look, truck driver is the number one job title by state. It looks like Utah is where you want to be, right? If Utah or Seattle, if you're going to the new future, because we're going to need a lot of software developers. But that's a lot of people. That's a lot of social change. I mean, that it's significant. Anybody here read Guns, Germs, and Steel? All right. Remember the two tribes, right? They got split up. And what they found, you know, when you go back and you look at it from an anthropology position, because of the terrain, one tribe had to be hunters, one tribe got to be farmers. The hunters were actually pretty decent people. Because hunters didn't have a lot of time to think about war, right? You have to have small groups. You don't want a big group if you're a hunting tribe. You're constantly moving, so you're not attached to any piece of land. And you got to keep eating. If you're a farmer, right, then you got time on your hands, so you can specialize. You can gather up food. You need more land, and you need to protect the land you are. So in Guns, Germs, and Steel, he talks a lot about these two tribes that got set apart by continental drift and how violent the farmers became. Now, think about us for a second here. That's a lot of people out of work now, right? That's a lot of people. What's the societal impact? Do we have a universal living wage to take care of people who can't adjust? How do we do this? It's a big question. Robots. You can drive it, you're gonna load it. But yeah.
I mean, when you get it to where it's going, it's still gotta get loaded.
Yeah. Now, making the case the other way, Nick runs transportation in California. At any time, about 6% of his jobs are open for bus drivers. 3 to 5% of his bus drivers are on some kind of FMLA. So in Southern California, they are always running 10 to 12% short on drivers. This is a terrible chart. It's a great friend who did the chart and unfortunately gave it to me in a PDF, so I couldn't do it any better. But it's an interesting one to look at. IP Capital, these guys track patents. So these are patents around services that were put out last year that relate to autonomous vehicles. And there's a lot of things you wouldn't think. If you notice, there's dining patents. So somebody has applied for a patent that has something to do with autonomous vehicles that has to do with dining. Sightseeing. So that's one loyalty program. Somehow somebody's attached, I don't know if it's your Kroger card or something, to driverless cars. So these, if you're not thinking about how to make money off this, your brother should be into it, right?
Right.
If you're not thinking how to make money off this, you're slow. And then here was the interesting thing to me. Here's who those patents were assigned to. So I don't know who the individual inventor is, but he's kicking some butt, or she's kicking some butt. But it's interesting, the people, you notice you don't see a lot of Ford, GM, Toyota in there. But you do see the software companies. Yeah, that's where it's unknown, unassigned.
Ah,
yeah. Yeah, exactly. And that's my company. We do our patents that way. We keep them that way because I don't want to tell the competitors what I'm doing. American Express is getting patents on driverless vehicles. Okay, I'm going to jump into a little bit of what my company does. So what you see there, that's a camera that sees horizon to horizon. And that's kind of the start of our product. What we do is we connect that in to what's an industrial PC effectively. That's going to capture images like you see them here. It's going to track anything that moves. And this little computer here is going to tell the light when to turn green. It's going to keep that, we count, we get information. We count size, we tell you where the cars went, we track things. It's random, it's anonymous, but we provide all that data back. And to show you how a little thing can change, we have a camera that's on Kingston Pike and North Shore. Formerly, you had to wait and make a protected left there. You had a green arrow, you had to wait for the arrow. They changed it to a permissive left. A little more dangerous, means you can turn left whenever you want. 4,000 cars a day more started going through that intersection. 10% increase. We actually have 45,000 vehicles a day go through Kingston Pike and North Shore. This is Knoxville. I don't know the answer to that. Yeah, we don't track that. That's on the police side. So I don't know if it's increased or not. But 10% more. So as a random, I walked into the couple of the restaurants around there and asked them how business was doing. And I heard universally, business has been picking up. We think the economy's getting better. Actually, you're getting 4,000 more looks a day.
Yeah. Is that a yellow arrow instead of a green arrow?
I don't know. I know. I looked at the logs to see what changed when I was analyzing the data. So I. That's what my camera sees. So it's a fisheye lens. We flatten it out for human consumption, but that's how we can see horizon to horizon. That's downtown Los Angeles there. That's my little commercial, fastest installation data to your inbox. It's low. We have a 5-megapixel camera, but we actually drop out 3-megapixel because of the processing. We don't need that. We don't need all the pixels to process, so it processes faster. We want to be at least 9 meters high and within 75 feet or so of the center of the intersection.
9 meters high. 9. 9. 9. 0. 9.
Yeah.
0. 9.
Oops.
0. 9. 0.
Yeah. 30 feet. Yeah. Yeah. So this is Alcoa here, and you'll see one of the reasons we're a value to the cities. If you look at those little blue boxes are user-defined zones where Alcoa wants to know when people go through there. And if you can see all the places we cover with one camera, how many other devices it would take, whatever kind they are. You also see, I turned on the models here, you can see us doing the same models, and this is why I know how far the other guys are, because I see our mistakes. Those numbers on there, for us, they're identifying numbers, but that's how Gridsmart works. And I'll talk in a little bit about how we can use that information to help us we get into driverless cars. That is a crazy freaking place to drive. They got a federal grant for that. Yeah. So one of the things that comes up with autonomous vehicles is left turn assist, right? You're pretty good at looking down the road, but sometimes you can get hindered when you're looking down, especially if you have a commercial vehicle. So if you walk with me on this one, imagine you got your black autonomous connected vehicle and you're sitting behind a truck, you got another truck, and you got a real nice lowrider right behind that, but you're trying to live off what you can see from sensors. So it sets you up in a really bad situation for left turns. If you think about how Gridsmart's able to track, we can let that connected vehicle understand what's coming and that he needs to hesitate for that left turn. Stop the jerking. By the way, it's the other thing you're going to see with connected vehicles. If you're driving behind them, they're going to frustrate the living crap out of you because they're going to drive like your grandmother. They're going to be slow. They're going to be safe. There's a thing out there called robot bullying. And you think about, do no harm, right? So what do? If you're riding down the road and some obnoxious bicyclist is speeding up next to you and you want to go right, and then when you slow down, he slows down. You jump him, a robot, you can just, it's trying, its only thing, it's slowing down, it's trying to adjust. I actually saw somebody crash the computer in the Google car. They came up to a four-way intersection and the guy just kept tapping his brake. So Google stopped to let him go, he hit his brake, thought it was safe to go, and just messing with him. So robot bullying, it's coming. So intersections are more complicated than just that one. You'll hear a term V2V, vehicle-to-vehicle communication, V2I, vehicle-to-infrastructure, that's us. And then there's nothing to vehicle, right, until we start implementing chips in us. But you imagine there, I got my connected vehicles up top there, and somebody wants to take their Beamer across, but the kids are crossing. We're able to tell you that there's kids or people in the intersection and stop. We, during our Intersect event last year, we had a demonstration project with Denso. And Denzel had a radio, and we did just this, right? We had a parked car, like a stalled car. The reporters and people came in with Denzel's car behind it with a 5.9 radio in it, Gridsmart system, and we had somebody walking in the street, and it would tell the Denzel car to stop. Now, where something can go terribly wrong is that a real driver, human unpredictability, got frustrated. We were going real slow because we had the media in the car, and double passed around us and almost took out my number one sales guy who was volunteering to walk. So now the new rule is the low man on the totem pole has to be the PED demonstration. Dynamic mapping. So again, and there's a lot of play. Google, it has to map absolutely, and other people are doing it, but they're a zillion miles ahead. They have to map for an autonomous vehicle. You have to know exactly where you can drive, but the road changes all the time, right? Things happen.
There's one simplification we're making on all the intersections. And that is, in this country, every piece of property has a right of access to a public right-of-way, and sometimes more than one. Now, and I know where there are intersections that, in all four of those corners, there are entrances to the traveled way within 30 feet of the corner.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And you're not going to be able to do that if you have driverless cars and intelligent devices without greatly complicating the problem beyond what it is now.
You have to learn. We can actually help for that. Well, thank you for that setup.
I hope so.
If you look how those two cars just went right around, what we're able to do by seeing and tracking everything is tell the autonomous vehicles, the last 15 cars have taken this path, you have a new path. So we're able to remap dynamically at the intersection.
Well, I think that, I don't know whether you all have talked about that or not, but if the property laws remain as they are, and driveway laws remain as they are, the only way you can tell the cars coming out and getting into the driveway is have some kind of sensor at the threshold where the crossing occurs.
Yes.
Great good friends and developers will scream bloody murder about that, because it obviously wrecks the project and cost a huge amount of money.
Unless you got a Gridsmart camera, well, all you have to do is draw it. You could draw a zone anywhere.
Good heavens.
That was your contractor friend. The other thing is, you know, you've heard the old thing, if a plane's a degree off, these vehicles are going to have to be calibrated, right? If you're a degree off, if you're a half degree off from where your GPS is, sitting where we're at and it's static, we have the ability to go ahead and recalibrate, validate that you're where you think you are geographically. All right, so I've got past Gridsmart. I want to go back a little bit into my conspiracy theory, just because I like this stuff and I can do it. Who knows who Ralph Nader is? Yeah? Does anybody know how Ralph Nader got started? His first big break, yeah. So Ralph Nader, he figured out that the Chevy Corvair was a phenomenally dangerous car. It would flip over in left-hand turns. What was really bad was it was a beautiful car, and it was very enticing. And GM chose, they were over budget, so they chose not to put a $12 part on it that would have stabilized it. And lots of people got killed because of it. And Ralph Nader wrote a book about it called Unsafe at Any Speed. Well, GM fired private investigators. So this stuff doesn't just happen in the movies. This is 1960s Detroit. They started interviewing his friends. They were trying to figure out if he was a homosexual. They were trying to figure out if he was a communist. They were trying to figure out if he went to the wrong church. They sent women. They sent a woman of ill repute to try to get him to do something wrong, saying that she was a communist so she could prove he's a communist. They sent another woman who they don't know what the intent was, but again, to try to seduce him. And they made midnight calls to his family, threatening him. When it got before Congress, the first thing GM said was, anybody can hire a private detective to follow anyone. And then they kind of backed down. As you know, it wasn't like social media today, right? It took a little while. And GM finally tucked their tail between their legs and backed down. Mm-hmm. And that was the start of him as a consumer advocate. He underwent a lot. But again, this whole idea that it's OK, it's Google, or it's OK, it's Microsoft. Yeah. I mean, it used to be the saying, right? What's good for GM's good for America? Mm-hmm. You know.
That's an old phrase.
It's an old mind. Customer service, right? Where's customer service the worst? Where you don't have choices, you know, really outside of retail, where you don't have choices. And we're, I was in the plane mess we had a couple weeks ago here in Knoxville, and as they were getting us off the plane after sitting on the tarmac for 2 hours and a half, they were putting somebody else on, and it hit me. They were doing that even though they knew those people were going to have to sit in the plane for 2 hours here in Knoxville because they didn't want to deal with two planes at the same time. They have that kind of power when you lose your ability to move around. So the promise of autonomous vehicles, right? That's what we're hearing. Right? We're going to surf the internet. You know, we're going to call our friends. We're going to tweet. You know, man, I'm a millennial. This sucks. Now, that's the promise. But how's that working out with airlines? Right? If you, that happens to be Mick Jagger's daughter. I didn't find her on purpose. I was just looking for a picture of a big airline seat, but I read it. But if you can afford that kind of airline seat, I'm sure you're going to get the same thing in an autonomous vehicle or a rideshare. If you can't, right? And competition will matter. Who gets direct flights out of Knoxville, right?
Have your own corporate jet.
Yeah. So I think there's tremendous potential. There's 35,000 lives, 40,000 lives this year that can be saved. There's access to the elderly. There's social issues to go through. You know, who is going to serve East St. Louis, Northwest Detroit, Watts? I love the small town names. I did have fun with those. You know, Bald Butt, Montana. Who's going to be there? Monkey's Eyebrow, Arizona. We know Manhattan's going to be taken care of, right? And who's going to go into Cabrini Green? I mean, I guess that's getting better if anybody knows Cabrini Green, but it's a housing project in Chicago where there was gang wars between the floors. Yeah, it's what they did is they kicked all the poor people out. It fixed it real well. The crime went way down. But, so there's, for you history buffs, right, there's the Group of Five that did the groundwork for the Constitution. And I think about this, and again, people laugh, but, you know, think about during that point in time if the British could have said, hey, you know those five guys that are meeting? Have their autonomous horse bring them here. Is he in the group? No, he wasn't. Was he in it? See? This is why I don't speak at universities. They're smart people. One of the people in that picture there, Mr. Franklin, I've always loved the quote he set up on signing the Declaration. But again, I encourage you to think about it. There is a lot of great things that can happen with autonomous vehicles. But we got to balance the power. It does matter. It's not, I don't have anything to hide. It does matter. I'm going to, by the way, anybody can call me or email me at any time, but I come up with something. It just hit me at the end, and it's, again, from being old, from my younger days, there's a band called Rush that was way out ahead of themselves when they put out a song in 1980 about a world where you're not allowed to drive, and the guy having his uncle's car and them taking it out for rogue rides in the middle of the night. Should have maybe Geddy Lee from Rush be the guy who's giving this talk about what's coming in the future. But it's something that's predictable. It's coming. It's not going to change. I would say that we always deserve the right to drive. They say that it's a technology, it's a bad thing, but I don't see on one hand you can say this is going to happen and it's going to be great because we can do things with technology, but we can't solve this. I think there always needs to be a room and a place where we have the ability to control our own transportation. That's all I got other than I want that car.